honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air, number 117, on karma and the process of awakening. And you are indeed welcome here in this nice autumn Danish forest. Thank you.
Friends, what are the seven links to awakening? The seven Sambuyangas. One, awareness is a link to awakening. Sati Sambuyanga. Two, investigation is the link to awakening. Vichaya Sambuyanga. Three, energy is a link to awakening. Virya Sambuyanga. Four, joy is a link to awakening. Pitti Sambuyanga. Five, tranquility is a link to awakening. Pasati Sambuyanga. Six, concentration is a link to awakening. Samadhi Sambuyanga. Seven, equanimity is a link to awakening. Upekkha Sambuyanga. These are the seven links leading to final mental enlightenment. Friends, this Dhamma evaporates the mental hindrances. Unhindered is such elevation. The Blessed Buddha once said, when Bhikkhus, a noble disciple, listen carefully to the Dhamma, alert with keen ears, attending to it as a matter of crucial concern, indeed as something of vital importance, directing his entire mind to it. In that very moment, the five mental hindrances are absent in him. On that occasion, the seven links to awakening approaches complete fulfillment. And what are the five mental hindrances that are absent on that occasion? The mental hindrance of sense desire is all absent on that very occasion. The mental hindrance of ill will is all absent in this exact moment. The mental hindrance of lethargy and laziness is all absent during that period. The mental hindrance of restlessness and regret is all absent on that event. The mental hindrance of doubt and uncertainty is all absent in that interval. The five mental hindrances are thus entirely absent in that very moment. And what are the seven links to awakening that approaches fulfillment there? The awareness link to awakening develops toward complete fulfillment. The investigation link to awakening arises and approaches fulfillment. The enthusiastic energy link to awakening also pushes forward towards fulfillment. The joy link to awakening elevates and moves towards complete fulfillment. The tranquility link to awakening silently comes to a stealth fulfillment. The concentration link to awakening absorbs into one-pointed fulfillment. The equanimity link to awakening also gains fulfillment by development. These are the seven links to awakening that are fulfilled by development on that very occasion. When Bhikkhus, a noble disciple listens carefully to the Dhamma, alert with keen ears, attending to it as a matter of crucial concern, as something of vital importance, directing his entire mind to it. On that very moment, the five mental hindrances are absent in him. On that occasion, the seven links to awakening develop towards complete fulfillment. At another occasion, a certain bhikkhu once asked the Blessed Buddha, "Venerable sir," it is said, clever and wise. In what way, Venerable sir, can one be rightly called clever and wise? The Buddha then answered, "Bhikkhu, it is because one has indeed developed and cultivated these seven links to awakening that one rightly is called clever and wise." What seven? 1. The awareness link to awakening. 2. The investigation link to awakening. 3. The energy link to awakening. 4. The joy link to awakening. 5. The tranquility link to awakening. 6. The concentration link to awakening. 7. The equanimity link to awakening. It is because one has indeed developed and made much of these seven factors of enlightenment that one is called clever and wise. And these edited extracts are from the Connected Sayings of the Buddha, the Samyutta Nikaya, Book 5, Section 46, on the Links to Awakening, the Sambuyanga, and his Sutta number 38, Unhindered, and Sutta number 5, Intelligent.
Hello to you, friends. This is indeed Dhamma on Air number 117 in the late November forest of Denmark in the middle of Zealand. There are three questions circling around karma and awakening, but first the normal intro. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha indeed. First, a little advertisement for the meditation course in North Carolina, USA, from the 20th December next month, which you see here is an old wooden hotel. There are still seats open. You're very welcome. All 40 meditation objects by the Buddha will be taught, and the six main of them will be trained in detail. Just go to whatbuddhasaid.net and then click for meditation course and then apply for a seat. It's on the Hardwood Retreat Center, which you see here, a very nice old wooden hotel, very suitable for the place. It will be a silent, both calm and insight, Samahita and Vipassana meditation course. Thank you. Then we go to the questions. Question 359. Is it skillful for a female to give prey, help, or offer a merit to become a man so as to attain Nibbana? One doesn't have to become a man to attain Nibbana. That's a misunderstanding. Both male and females can attain Nibbana, and from human level or up. Lower than human, from animal level and down, they cannot attain Nibbana. But humans can, both male and female. So this means awakening, enlightenment as a disciple is possible for a woman and a man equally, you can say. And it's the same Nibbana you in all cases reach, whether you are a male, a female, a Samasambuddha, or a Pachika Buddha, a solitary Buddha. So this is not a qualification to be a man. Both sexes can enlighten. And this is seen in all Sanghas, under all the Buddhas, that there are four members, different kind of members. There's bhikkhus and bhikkhunis, Buddhist monks and nuns, and then there are
upasakas and upasikas. This means Buddhist lady disciples, female and male. So they definitely, females can enlightened without becoming a male. However, there are examples, a few in the text, that very prominent Dayakas supporters of the Sangha gave to the Buddha or invited the Buddha for 7 days with all his 500 monks in order to become a man and then be able to proceed to bodhisattvahood and then become a Buddha much, much later, many lives later. So this, one can say, is not necessary to be enlightened as a disciple, Savaka Bodhi, but if one wants to enlighten as a solitary Buddha, a private Buddha, a Pachika Buddha, then one has to become a man. And this even more so if one likes to become a Sammasambuddha, like the Buddha Gautama. They are all male. So also is all kings of the 33s, all Maras, all Brahmas, they are also male. But one should not get any inferiority complex from that, but because you can say we humans are also much less and have much less degrees of freedom than any deva, whether male or female. So it's just a matter of your current position, which again is guided by the karma, the past karma, and not much else actually. So in all cases, one should recognize that this karma, this probability creation, one should recognize in this past karma, whether way of speech, thought, or bodily action, this really is what creates one's present state. So all beings are born of their karma. Karma is their womb. They are created by their karma. They are conditioned, restricted, and liberated also by their karma. Whatever they do, good or bad, only they will feel the result thereof, because they are owner, inheritor, and debtor to their karma. So basically, karma is the only thing one can take, the individual can take, or the individuality can take with he or she to the other side of death. One cannot take the body or physical characteristics or external possessions. Anything of this world cannot be brought with, except this probability, basically because it is everywhere, present. This probability one will therefore meet at the other side of death also, and pick up because one is tuned to this particular frequency, this probability is embedded in a wave of. So one will, it's like you're going around in an echo valley with a certain tone, and only you will hear that tone. And this means only you will experience the echoes of these prior actions. And this also goes for being male, female, being discipleship, or awakened as a Samasambuddha, or whatever. Whatever. So, in short, it is skillful to give, to become a male in order with the intention of becoming a Samasambuddha or Pachika Buddha for a female. Definitely skillful. It's definitely advantageous. But at the same time, I have to say it is not particularly necessary if one wants to enlighten as a disciple under another Buddha or under the pupil of another Buddha. Then it's not necessary to become a male, because as I said, both male and female, whether lay or monastic, can enlighten. And it's the same Nibbana they enter at the moment of death. So, I hope this answers the questions. Question 360. Why do even enlightened persons like the Buddha and disciples like Maha Mogllana have to go through both pleasant and unpleasant situations, even though all the good and bad karmas are exhausted for liberated people? This is not the case. Good karma and bad karma is not exhausted because you become awakened.
What happens at awakening is that the rest of one's actions are not creating karma, they are kriya karma, or neutral karma, or functional karma. So they doesn't accumulate any probabilities for future states. After awakening, however, what was created upstream in the past that has not yet been exhausted, that had not yet been utilized, these probabilities that had not yet been utilized, they still have to be exhausted. So enlightenment does not necessarily say that you have zero accumulation of karma. That only the case of enlightenment right at the moment of death. Then it's the case. But otherwise, the Buddha said that there are two Nibbanas actually. Nibbana sa upatisesa. Nibbana with a rest remaining. And Nibbana an upatisesa. Nibbana without any trace of probability of karma left. And there is this case where he said that there's a person who enlightened, who have this, who goes around with this body and five senses intact, but have understood the Four Noble Truths completely and have eliminated all the mental fermentations. The fermentation of ignorance and of use, of sensuality, and the fermentation asava of becoming. All these wrong assumptions this person has eliminated. So they see reality just as it really is. Ta ta ta. However, one can conclude because they have a body, because they have a consciousness, there must still be some probability holding this together. And this is what their past karma is doing until they die. So from the moment of enlightenment until the moment of death, then there are Nibbana sa upatisesa, with traces remaining. Traces of clinging remaining, sa upatisesa. Is it they are clinging now? No, they're not clinging now, but there has been clinging in the past that has not yet been exhausted. And this clinging in the past, clinging to sensuality, seeing, hearing, tasting, touching, smelling, feeling, and thinking, this is still there, and clinging to becoming and clinging to not becoming, this and that. The traces of that clinging have taken place in the past are still with them. So they have a tank, we have a tank also, of accumulation, accumulated probability, which is basically the karma. It is stored everywhere, we don't carry it around our back, but we meet it everywhere we come. And it will determine our feelings, our actions, and the event we experience. Basically, the observations we make. So this accumulation of probability is not exhausted for beings that are enlightened before the moment of death. At the moment of death, then it is exhausted, and then their body will fall apart. So that's why Maha Mogllana, who experienced before he died, that there were some robbers lying outside outside his meditation hut, waiting for him every day to come to beat him up. They were kind of like hired killers from other sects that were very envious at the Buddhist monks because they received all the support. And then they hired some killers to kill Maha Mogllana. Why had they done this? Only their own evil intention? No, as often as with karma, it is many factors playing together. And this was the case that the Maha Mogllana in this very universe, long time back, had killed his mother and father. Why so? Because he has a very delicate wife, very beautiful wife, and she didn't want to take care of his elderly parents, which were blind and had to be washed every day for urine and excrement and so on in the 80s or 90s. And so she asked them, he had no brothers and sisters, she asked Mogllana to get rid of them. But he resisted for years, but eventually he was persuaded by this young, beautiful wife and his own attachment to her sexual services to
get rid of them. And this is he did by taking up them up, saying, "I will have to go to the forest and collect firewood." Then he took them up in the ox cart and drive them out in the forest and went into the forest, say, "I'd go into some and collect some firewood." And then he came back with a club and clubbed them to death. And then his mother yelled out in the, she was blind, she couldn't see it was him. He was silent. She yelled out into the forest, "Maha Mogllana, Maha Mogllana, don't come back because there's robbers here." Not knowing that it was the very same son she had that were killing her slowly. And that's why you see him on figures that he has a blue color, bluish color, that he remained to have to the end of his karmic career. And after having escaped, he during the last life together with the Buddha, where he was an Akasavaka, one of the prime disciples, two disciples, together with Sariputta, then he considered after 3 months, he escaped these robbers by going out, it said, through the chimney as a very small thing, so they couldn't see him, and he came back the same way. But after 3 months going out and then going begging around, coming back through the chimney as a very small spyfly-like thing, then he considered, "Can I escape this? What is it? Is it my karma?" And then he looked back into his own past and saw this action, that he had killed his own mother and father and went to hell, but now coming back there was remaining traces of poor ability left. Then he saw that he could not escape it. And then eventually he went out the door and got beaten up, and they said all his bones were broken. So he then went back to the Buddha, flying through the air with all this broken bones, bleeding from nose and everywhere. Imagine, huh? Truly a superhero feat, if anything is. And asked for permission to take his leave before he died. And then the Buddha praised him and said, "It's good that you have come, Mogayana, because this is my last time to see one like you." And this was definitely a compliment to this superhero disciple that came back basically with all his bones broken to take leave before dying. So this is an example. Maha Mogllana was enlightened 2 weeks after he entered the Sangha, and the same with Sariputta. So he had been enlightened long before this, but he still had a body and he still had some karma remaining. So he had entered at the moment of his enlightenment. He had entered Nibbana sa upatisesa, Nibbana with remnants left. And then at the moment of death, he entered Nibbana an upatisesa, Nibbana without remnants or traces left. So this is the answer. Karma, the accumulation of karma does not go to zero before dying as an arahant. Not at the moment of enlightenment, if you are enlightened in this very life. So I hope this clears these issues. Again, there's this kriya or kriya, this karmically neutral actions, inert actions, that arahants do without preference, in complete equanimity. And I will place a link here down there so you can go and see this. They are neither advantageous kusala, nor are they disadvantageous, nor are they resultants, karma results vipaka. So it's a special kind of action that doesn't make any accumulation of probability. It's completely neutral. It's completely inert. It's completely functional. It doesn't make any echo. So old yet unexhausted karma accumulated before awakening thus still have to be experienced. Still have to be experienced. So it shows also something how strong this karmic accumulation is. As the Buddha say, one cannot run away from it, basically because it is everywhere. And he said, if you dive down on the bottom of the ocean and hide in a cave under the bottom of the ocean, you will still not escape it. And we can say also, if you go to another planet or another galaxy, you will still not escape it. Why no? Not because this is omnipresent, this field of vibration embedding this probability called the universal quantum mechanical wave function in physics, basically the same thing. So it is everywhere present. It is an echo or a field of probability, just like a field of magnetism or a field of light, like for example cosmic background radiation. It is also all over in the entire universe with the same intensity, coming, not seeming to coming from anywhere, but being present with the same intensity, almost the same intensity everywhere. So this is the explanation. The karma is everywhere. And so it's not to be, one cannot, it will keep promulgating or making the individual experience new things according to what this probability says should happen, these possible outcomes. Until these possible outcomes has not been exhausted, that they have come out or been counteracted, either exhausted or counteracted, then this karma still have a positive value. And as long as there is this accumulation of karma that is not zero, then the person cannot attain this Nibbana and Upadhisesa, which is attained for an arahant being at the moment of death. In this regard, there is a interesting story in the Visuddhimagga about an elderly monk at Sri Lanka. He asked he was an Anapanasati breathing meditation expert, and he asked his students whether they have seen, they came home from the Upasatakara, where they recited the Vinaya rules at the fortnight of the full moon or new moon. And then he asked on their way back whether they have seen a person awakened lying down. Yes, they had. Sitting up. Yes, they had. Standing up. Yes, they had. Have they seen anyone attaining Nibbana and Upadhisesa while walking? No, they had not. Then he said, I'll show you. Then he took a stick and then draw a line in the sand. And then says, you see this stone down there? Yes. I'll go down to this stone and then I will come back. And at the moment my toe crosses this line, then I will attain Nibbana and Upadhisesa and drop dead on the very spot. Then he very calmly went down to the other side, turned around, came back. And at the moment his toe crossed the line, then he dropped down there and attained Nibbana and Upadhisesa. And this is characteristic of experts in Anapanasati breathing meditation, that they know their own death moment exactly to the very second. And since he was already enlightened, sa Upadhisesa, with remnants, he could say, and now I'll come back and attain complete unsurpassable enlightenment, where there is no probability not even to sustain the body being together with the mind. I hope this answers these questions. The last question, 361, is a lot of questions actually. Why is milk and unfertilized egg to be avoided, as consuming them does not involve killing of animals? Milk and unfertilized milk and even meat can be eaten, according to the Buddha, blamelessly, if it's not seen, heard or suspected that they have been killed, if one is a monk, for the monk's sake. And this is a case because vegetarian food does also involve indirect killing. Plowing, use of insecticides, pesticides, plucking, taking down, chopping down wood, threshing, and so on. Millions of worms and insects are dying because of these processes. So both in the case of eating meat and eating vegetarian food, there is indirect killing. What is not, then this, so there's indirect killing, then when the food comes to you, then it's already dead, not connected with the consciousness. Because it's not connected with consciousness, one can't partake of it blamelessly, because it doesn't suffer. Because now it's food, basically. It's like this tree, there can be beings inside the tree, but the tree itself like this, for example, like this stick here, it doesn't suffer if I eat it, because it's not connected to consciousness. And the same thing with eggs and milk and so on. However, it's not particularly healthy. Both eggs and milks are created by nature, not for human consumption, but for somebody else, basically. So it was meant for somebody else. And from this point of view, I think vegetarian food is more advantageous. But it is blameless if it's, I repeat, not seen, heard or suspected that it's killed for one's sake, or that oneself has partaken in the killing. So milk and unfertilized eggs can definitely be eaten. However, again, one should think about, you know, these unfertilized eggs. Still, one can say, under what circumstances has the chicken lived that has produced these eggs? And then one might buy ecological eggs, or eggs where the chickens has a better circumstances than standing in these very small cages, just producing eggs, even though they're unfertilized. So this is another issue that has nothing to do with killing, but has to do with the life of the chicken. And this same goes, of course, for cows, where the cows have had a decent life. They produce this milk. But they didn't produce the milk for humans, you know. They produced the milk for the calves in the first place. And this is also worth remembering. Why did the Buddha have to face both pleasant and unpleasant situations after his enlightenment? As liberated beings are beyond the fruits of karma. Again, it's the same answer. The Buddha also had a bad back. He has once in his former life, he once asked Sariputta to continue speaking through all the night to the monks, because he had to lie down and rest his back. He has his back hurt him. And then the commentary says that he had a bad back because he has broken the back of a wrestler at one time in one past life, where he was a wrestler, market wrestler, where they were wandering around from marketplace to marketplace and then wrestling for money and betting and so on. And then he had said to himself, now I have this competitor, it was his worst rival, should I break his back or not? And then he decided to break his back. So he broke his back on his competitor, which then were lame from the hips down the rest of his life. And then, of course, he couldn't wrestle anymore. So he was freed from his competitor. But then after that, this problem of having pain in the back followed him life after life after life after life. And also in his last life, even though he was enlightened. So it's a misunderstanding that enlightened person does not come under the law of karma. All alive beings does so. The karma is only fully exhausted at the moment of death for the enlightened being. Because then there will be no re-becoming, and there's no feeling, no perception, no mental construction, and in particular no consciousness that re-arises in the next moment to experience all past karma. So that's the case. Same story as before. There's these two Nibbanas, Nibbana and Upatissesa, which is what you attain finally as an enlightened being at the moment of death. And then there's Nibbana, sa upadisesa. Sa upadisesa. And sa with upadisesa, traces of clinging left. Not clinging that has happened after the enlightenment moment, but clinging that happened before the enlightenment moment, and even in former lives. As in the case of the Buddha, his back pain was caused by a evilness he'd done towards a wrestler many lives ago. But there were still remnants, traces left of this action, this evil action, done to cling to popularity and to the money he could earn as a wandering wrestler. What karmic causes decide the type of animal one gets, like cow, cat, raccoon, horse, dog, bird, scorpion? In one particular species are there also different types. Some dogs are more ferocious than others. Yes, animal rebirth in general is caused by ignorance. And then one can say, The text doesn't say much about which particular actions cause which particular animal to or animal karma to be experienced. However, it one can say if one has ignorance and anger, then usually one will be a predator animal, that is killing other animals for food, and then this will even propel this certain being downwards on an even further, more deleterious path, going from one animal to a lower animal to a lower animal to a lower animal, and until this karma is exhausted. And this could be a very long process. If there's a greed that adds, then one will usually be a herbivore and one who eats a lot. One usually I spend a lot of time like dogs, and they are very greedy. So they could be an example upon somebody who is both have ignorance and then greed, but possibly also a little anger. Like we all have. We have all three roots of ignorance, greed and anger. But so it doesn't say anything about specifically. However, there are some hints. If one has been very cruel, then one will, as a human being, and then forced to the animal level, one will also be very cruel as an animal. And this usually entails that one will be a spider or an insect, which is generally regarded lower. Animals living in the sea are regarded lower than animals living on the land. The highest regarded as animal on the land would be the elephant. And the last two of the 10 next Buddhas, that is Buddha number 8 and 10 from here, no, from the 9 and 10 from here, they were elephants at the Buddha's time. One was called Paireya. So, this entails big, gentle herbivore animals are generally regarded as the best, having the best karmic accumulation, while insects, predator insects like spiders, that are killing other insects the most cruel way by spinning them in and then sucking them out by after having injected enzymes into them, they are regarded as possibly the lowest. And even though lower in this ocean, where the blue whale probably is regarded as the best animal existence. But what specific action had been performed is often not mentioned. And this is also, I think, because it's an accumulation of many actions that propel the being into an animal existence. It is worth noticing that the Buddha was once asked whether he could illustrate how long time it would take and how difficult it was to come from animal existence to human existence. And there's this famous story about the blind turtle. And he said, yes, I can illustrate in the possible way. You have a ring. He used the example of a yoke, that you have a yoke around the bull's neck when they are blowing. And so he said, the seven oceans, they are roaring and being stormy, and then you throw out the yoke, and the yoke drifts around in 100 years. Then there's a blind sea turtle that cannot see anything, and it only dives up every 100 years. The chance of becoming a human after having become animals is the same as the chance of the sea turtle diving out with the head right into the ring without seeing it, even though the ring is drifting about for 100 years in the stormy waters of the seven oceans. So to find this probability formally, one should, I not calculate it, but nevertheless, one should take the area of the ring, and then up to that should be divided the area of the seven oceans. Then you get a non-zero number, but it's very, very small, but it's not zero. And the same thing for going goes for the chance of becoming a human being after having been an animal. It is very, very small, very, very small. And if one thinks about becoming more, there's becoming more and more humans, yeah, then it could be a chance or an expression that are beings passing up from the animal level up to the human level. And there are also devas falling down, but there are also human beings falling down to the animal level and humans being entering up to the deva level, I think the flow upwards in downwards is from above is very, very small compared to the flow upwards and downwards to the animal level from the human level. And this together, and also the recirculation of humans at the human level, will determine how many humans there are. And this seems to be increasing very slowly. Now we are, I think, 7 billion on planet Earth, 7 billion humans. And this is, I think, compared to earlier time, much more than, for example, at the Buddhist time. There's an animal, a bird, animal being that is responding to our speech. That's okay. So, does giving a restaurant dinner where the guests choose meat dishes result in bad karma? No, it does not. Why not? Because that choice, let's say you gave in, you can take what you want, and then they choose meat instead of vegetarian food. This is their karma. And basically still it is blameless as long as they not killed the animal themselves or ordered it to be killed, or somebody have killed it for their sake. So it's karmically blameless. But in any instance, their choice, if they pick a choice down at the menu card, then it is their choice. So when it's their choice, it's also their karma, basically. So it's their action. And whether another one pays for it or not, it doesn't matter, really. The one who gives a dinner to somebody else at a restaurant, he will reap good karma from that, irrespective of what they choose, whether they choose meat or vegetarian food. And again, I think this vegetarian issue should be kind of like seen as it is, that vegetarian food is not more deleterious because many beings are killed, worms and insects are killed to get this vegetarian food, whether it's fruits or corn or whatever. So it's not more innocent that than meat food are in this sense. The Buddhist doctor Jivaka once asked the Buddha about it. And then he said, what do you think, Jivaka? There's this monk, he goes out into the morning and collects food with his begging bowl. And then he comes back and then he eats the food and then he sits down and then he beams universal friendliness this way, friendliness this way, goodwill this way, goodwill this way, goodwill this way, goodwill this way, for several hours. And this he does again in the evening. Universal friendliness, goodwill and harmlessness, this way, this way, this way, this way, this way, and this way. What do you think, Jivaka? Is he blameless or blameful? And then Jivaka said, yes, of course he is blameless. And this is because he has not asked for getting whatever food he gets, whatever scraps of fish or whatever there might be in the sauce he gets in the begging bowl. He's not asked for it. And he is constantly working on the benefit for all beings by beaming this goodwill. And he also teaches that. So of course he's blameless. This points to the fact that it doesn't depend on what you eat. It depends on what you do, what you say, what you think. So this being the case, if there's no evilness in this doing, saying and thinking, and there's not if you partake of food that has, where it has not been seen, heard or suspected that it has been killed for your sake, well then, this, it depends on this karma then. This karma of beaming goodwill towards all beings in all directions, ideally at all times. How can there be any harmful in that? It's impossible. It's impossible. Irrespective of what you eat. Irrespective of you. You should eat something. And as you already noted, indirect killing is the same whether you eat meat or vegetarian food. Same. Same. There's no difference. Whether a billion worms are killed or one chicken is killed. Yes, it's true that the billions of worms and insects have smaller and less developed consciousness. Yes, but then there are many more of them, thousands or millions of them per chicken. So it's difficult, I think, functionally impossible to distinguish the harmful effect one chicken or a billion worms and insects, I think. Who should you pick? So there's this notice of breaking down the barriers between all beings, and this also goes for all beings at various levels of existence. The breaking down of the barriers is illustrated by a simile of the tent, where you sit inside a tent and you have your worst enemy, your best friend, a neutral person. And then the robbers come and ask you, one should be delivered, one person, to their robber god and offered, who is going to be, you can choose. And then one sits there meditating on this one, and then one should pick oneself. But in the start, one will pick, of course, one's worst enemy. And last one, one's best friend. And before that, the neutral person. But breaking down the barriers between this neutral person, the enemy and the friend and oneself, is what is done with this, that all beings should be happy. And this also goes for all insects and worms, and also all chickens and cows and so on. Since it's not possible, we could say we could eat chemical food. And this might be possible in the future, chemically grown food, chemically grown beef, and so on, that has no consciousness and that's not connected with any insect life or other beings living in proximity of this chemical food, but astronaut food. But this is probably some way into the future yet. Question 5. Are there more than 200 precepts for monks to follow? Yes, monks have to follow 227 rules. And nuns have to follow 311 rules. Then there are additional rules, but they are not in the Patimokkha, the thing you recite every fortnight, that is expression of the rules. There are only these 227 and 311 for monks and nuns, respectively. Why are there different numbers for monks and nuns? Yeah, the Buddha only put forth rules, both for monks and nuns, when necessary. And so they were accumulated over a 20-year period. The first 20 years of the Buddha's career as a leader of the Sangha, there were no rules, because only the good guys came to the Sangha. Then not so good guys and nuns started to ordain, and then rules were necessary to prevent this and to prevent that and so on. But it was first after an event, and in the when you read the rules, the Patimokkha is 5 volumes actually. Then always is the first event that put down the rule. It is always mentioned why the rule was made, because the Buddha wants the freedom for the monks and the nuns to be as free as possible. So the less the rules, the better. But if it's something that destroys the Sangha and destroys the people, faith in the Dhamma, then there has to be made a rule about it. And so all Buddhas only make rules when it's necessary. And in the Buddha Gautama's case, it was first after 20 years of the Sangha's presence on planet Earth that it became necessary. Is going for arms round with a begging bowl to ask for food necessary for monks? No, not necessarily, yet it's very good practice as long as one is healthy and one lives in a country that they understand where this, what this begging round means. Did I do so and did the Buddha do so? Yes, I did for 7 years and my knee broke down. Then I couldn't go, at least not in the mountain area of Sri Lanka where I usually hang out. But I could possibly go in a flat area, like inside town. I went 2 years with a swelled knee, and then I got surgery. But still, I still have trouble with it every day. The Buddha, he also went for the first 20 years, I think, of his career. Then he lived mostly on Jetavana Monastery the last 20 years, but also on other monasteries. And then he would go Pindabad whenever he was traveling about. All people will come with food. This is the 3 ways you can go. Either you go begging round, or you can have invitation to partake of food in certain houses or at the monastery by families, or the monasteries, all people can come and deliver food to you at the monastery or wherever you stay.
So you're not allowed with a permanent invitation. For example, my father, he's permanently invited to get food from him while I'm here. Then you're not allowed to take food from somewhere else, because then you miss the invitation that has already been given. And this also goes if you're invited out for a dana somewhere else, then you're not allowed to go to another dana or go begging around yourself, because then you miss the invitation, override the invitation already given. So if an invitation first is accepted, then one should are under obligation to come and fulfill of this partaking. Otherwise, one steals their karma, one steals their pin, their merit, their punya in pari, because they are not able to give as much as they could if one have followed up on this invitation to give dana. So going pindapat is not necessarily something that you do all the time, but it's very good to do. And for me, it was an extremely positive experience, because people are really happy to give. And you also have, there's some effect of it. In Burma, they still go a lot every day, to this very day. Usually before dawn, you see the monks come out, and also a little bit in Thailand. And not so much in Sri Lanka anymore. And in Denmark and Germany and Europe in general, it's very difficult to go. Some of my colleagues told me recently that they have tried, and then people didn't understand it. So in the only way to go to get something was to go in front of the supermarket or shops in general, and then stand there. Then people will ask them, even though you stand there. And I brought my bowl here, and you see my old begging bowl. I used to say this was my weapon, where I will challenge Mara and his armies with going around, because then people get merit from giving this to bowl. So you go with them, you take off the lid like this, and you go with the lid underneath, usually it's like this, open bowl, but you're not allowed to show it. So you just stand it with the rope like this, half covered. So you don't ask for anything specifically. You just show that you have an empty bowl. And this, you stand in front of people's houses. In Asia, they know it, because everybody have seen begging monks in their childhood. So they know if the monk stands with a bowl like this, then he's asking for something. And especially if you have come there before, you come to the same place every week, every weekday, then usually that's the case. But otherwise, here in Europe, they won't get it. You have to tell them. And these, my colleagues, they told me, only in the case they were standing in front of supermarkets, people will come up and ask them, why you stand like this? And it's, of course, very few. 1 out of 100, 2 out of 100. And then they would ask them, why you standing there? They don't explain, we're begging monks. We need food. What kind of food you need? Anything you like to give, then they will drop whatever they could have in their basket, or they will go and buy something, biscuits or whatever. So it's a culture that is a little bit difficult to replicate in Europe, but it's a very happy thing to do, and a good chance to give people, especially poor people, which are very happy to give. When I went in the poor areas around Kandy, They always, I get the bowl filled quickly, and then I have to cover it over and show that my bowl was filled and I could not receive any more that day. Then they will ask me to come back next day. While I went in the rich quarters, I never got anything, hardly anything. People were looking out the window and say, sorry, we don't have time today. And the fence was closed, two cars and so on. So that's a funny thing. Another experience I had with it was, I was coming at a place where there was a alcoholic living. And this alcoholic person, the first couple of years when I was living there, his wife was presenting me the food. And then she was very embarrassed over her husband. He was sleeping on the floor in his dirty clothes, being this alcoholic. And so she kind of like almost kicked to him. I didn't say anything. I received the food and went off. And of course, I knew the person, the family, the children, and so on. Then little by little, after some years, he was up when I came. He was not drunk the night before, or at least less so than before. And then eventually he was also shaved. And the last year I went out of this 7 years, then suddenly it was him dressed fully white, with fully shaven, that presented me with the food. Then his wife will stand smiling in the background. And this is because they feel embarrassed. Both the wife and the man felt embarrassed with the monk. They know not partake of alcohol, seeing that they were intoxicated. And the family was suffering from his lack of work and so on. And his alcohol abuse, which is very expensive. They were very embarrassed about it. But just by over a 7 year period, long time, huh? Nevertheless, there was this effect of this person coming there, seeing them, not saying anything, but they feeling very embarrassed of it. This cured the man to the extent that he was up, shaven, white clothing, and to give the food to the monk. And so this, I think, is good that the monks are seen in the streets every day. Can also be seen on the internet, but nevertheless that the monks are accessible to the people. So this influence of purity goes from the monastic sangha out in society. This, I think, is important. And I hope to come to go Pindapada again in this life later, when I come back, wherever it is possible. So many were the words today. Thank you for your advantageous attention, your clever consideration, and your kind contribution. Thank you to all the Dayakas, especially those regular donors who support with a small amount every month, which is indeed necessary here in this expensive country of Denmark. And thank you for today, and have a nice and noble day. Namo Tassu Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Bambarella, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy, thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. As the next Buddha, the noble Arya Ajita Mateya, will say, you can come as you like, but you pay as you go. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.